Morning Hollywood Community Church. We are in our second week of our new series called Disciple, where the challenge for each of us as God's disciples is to be one, make one, meaning we are disciples, so we should go out and make disciples. And so we've had this challenge. Pastor Brian last week laid out the fact that all of us have a calling to be a part of making disciples. But not only that, today we're going to look at the fact of that we're going to look at the cost of being a disciple who makes disciples. Is anybody in the room this morning terrified of a dentist besides me? Who hates going to the dentist? All right, good. I am not alone. Now, church, this is what I want us to understand. It is the year 2015, right? 2015. Yet when you walk into a dentist's office, they use a metal hook and a drill. I'm going to show you a picture. It is 2015, guys. We use lasers on our eyes, right? And we fix them. We put a man on a moon, yet when you go to the dentist, they dig in your gums and teeth with a hook, and then they go, your gums are bleeding. They weren't before I walked in. Surely are now. And so the dentist, here's what happened to me. I'm talking about the dentist because a few weeks ago, I was sitting down to a delicious bowl of Chex gluten-free cinnamon cereal covered with scrumptious almond milk. Doesn't that sound delicious? Welcome to my world. So anyways, I'm there getting ready to eat, and I take a spoonful of this cereal. I'm like, this is going to be good. Cinnamon cereal, you can't go wrong with cinnamon cereal. It's going to be delicious. I take a bite, and I'm like, it's cold. And I chew, boom, and the next thing I knew, lightning hit one of my teeth, because all I know is when it went into my mouth, what just happened? I had the worst shooting pain in my tooth. My hair was standing up. My whole body tensed. I think my shoes flew off. And I was like, what was that? And so I was like, let me try another bite. Maybe that was just something weird. So I tried another one. The same thing happened. And I look at my wife and I'm like, oh no, I have to go to the dentist. I have to figure something out. So thankfully, a few days away, I had an appointment with the dentist already to get a checkup where they just make my teeth hurt. And so I already had that appointment, so I go there. And I tell them, I say, look, I'm having this sensitivity, you know, it's kind of hurting, it's a lot hurting when I have something cold. So then the guy takes cold air and begins to blow it. And he's like, does that hurt? No. Does that hurt? No. Does that hurt? It hurts. So then he goes and writes something down on a chart. He comes back and he's like, let me check one more time. Goes right to where it's sensitive, blows the thing in it again. And then he goes, okay, tell me when it stops hurting. I ought to give you one of these. And so I tell him, okay, the pain's gone. And he's like, all right, you have a root canal. You need to go get it checked out. You need to go get it fixed. So I make an appointment with the oral surgeon. I go over to this guy, and he's like, and when I'm telling people about the fact I have to have a root canal, there is one thing people kept saying. As soon as I said, yeah, I got to have a root canal, they're like, ooh. That's a lot of money. And I'm like, what? Nah, yeah, that's a lot of money, and that's just to have the procedure. You're not even talking about the crown. The crown, that's a whole other. And I'm like, how bad could this be? A couple hundred bucks, right? It's not that bad. You guys are freaking out. You don't know what you're talking about. So I go to the oral surgeon, and he's sitting down. The first thing they do is, we want to take an x-ray. They ever put that x-ray in your mouth where it's too big, it's gagging you and choking you? And then it's digging into your gums, and they're like, okay, just sit there, but don't move. I'm like, lady, what do you mean don't move? Just take the picture. Hurry, hurry. So they take the picture. Then the guy, he sits down next to me, and he's got his little chart, and he's looking over here. Yes. And I'm sitting there like, what's going on? And he turns to me and goes, well, sir, you're going to have a root canal. Well, imagine that. It took you that long to figure out I needed a root canal. And he says, but here's the deal. Your insurance is going to pay half of it. And I was like, oh, sweet. Like, half of it, that's a good percentage. Like, at least I'm not paying 94%. And he said, okay, but here's the thing, though. Before we start, you have to know that your half is going to be due today. So I'm like, all right, couple hundred bucks. I got this. He's like, the cost for your part is going to be your house, one of your ears, your firstborn child, and a bag of Skittles. I'm like, what? I got to pay all of that? It was the large amount, like, I, like, swallowed. I was like, I contemplated being like, psych, I'm out. I don't need it. I'll just wait till it falls out. But here's what I knew, though. What made me stay in the medieval torture chair like this, what made me stay there was the fact that I knew that the reward of going through the cost far outweighed the cost. Does that make sense? I knew that the reward of having to pay all of that far outweighed the cost of paying for it. And so here's what I have to tell you. I'm in the process of doing it, but since I paid all that money and gave up my firstborn child, here's what I can tell you, that my tooth no longer hurts, that the reward was greater than the cost. I didn't see it as a cost or a sacrifice. I did it as this is saving my life because I can't function with this tooth pain. And so here's what I want to tell you this morning, church. When we speak about discipleship or making disciples, there are many Christians who think that the cost of discipleship is too high to pay. They sit back and they say, for me to be a disciple and make a disciple, that costs too much. That's going to take my time, it's going to take my money, it's going to take my energy, it's going to take my resources, so I'm just going to do nothing and let others who feel that they can do it, who have less to do than I do, I'll let them carry out the call of making disciples. And they'll say, no, Brad, you seriously, you don't understand. If I commit to be one and make one, I can lose friends, I can lose family. I would have to totally surrender everything I am. I would have to give up everything. I would have to give up my life, Brad. You don't understand. That cost is high. There's no way I can carry that burden. Church, we have to change our perspective about the cost of discipleship. Our world, our country, our state, our counties, our city, our church can no longer afford to believe that the cost of discipleship is a burden. Because when you view it as a burden, you do nothing. And we are called to make disciples because people without Jesus Christ are on a road to hell. And for us to say, do nothing, their souls are in danger. We have to change our perspective. So today, we're going to allow God's word, for Christ's words, to change our perspective to see that the reward of discipleship is greater than the cost of discipleship. Now, let me be fair, okay, because we can have a wrong perspective, but I think a lot of times in churches, we've helped you develop that wrong perspective. We focus on the fact that you are sinners, and to follow Christ, you need to give up everything. We harp on deny yourself. We harp on take up your cross. We harp on quit sinning, quit smoking, quit drinking, quit having sex, quit doing all these things. And when people hear that, they sit back and they go, well, I do all of those before 11 a.m. There's no way I can make this commitment to Jesus Christ. Because Jesus didn't say it's all about quitting. Our response, and when people ask us, why should I give those up, Brad? Why should I give all those things? Here's our answer as a church. Because Jesus commands it. Is there a lot of motivation in that? Do it because I said so? Do it because Jesus said so? And so we've helped to develop a wrong perspective about the cost of discipleship. And I was sitting in the financial peace class last Sunday, and I came across a picture, and the picture fits perfectly what I'm talking about, because there's many Christians who look at their life, and they look at the things they have that they would have to give up, And this, I'll put the picture up here so you could see it. It's got a donkey with a cart. And they're saying, Brad, you're telling me I have to give all this up because Jesus commands it? It's so much, Brad, I can't do it. The cost is too high, so what happens to people? They just hang around, not making disciples, not fulfilling the Great Commission, because they've learned that the cost of discipleship is a burden. And so they hold on to their stuff. They hold on to the things that are sacred. And so this morning, I want to challenge this perspective. Why would people pay the cost of discipleship? See, we're very good at saying, here's the cost, but we haven't done a great job of saying, why do we pay the cost? This morning, we're going to unpack that. I put a statement in your notes this way, and this is what I put. I put, the kingdom is greater than the cost of discipleship. The right perspective for viewing what we give up is the fact that the kingdom is greater than what the cost is to be a disciple. Does that make sense? Are you with me? Okay, so if you have your Bible, I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 13. We're going to dig into a few verses, and then I'm going to tell you for the rest of the message, we're going to be in different verses throughout the scriptures. And so don't feel like you have to be able to find every page and turn there. Every verse I use is in your notes. You can always go back and reference it later. I'll also have them on the screen for you. And so Jesus is talking, and he tells his disciples in Matthew 13, starting at verse 44, he says this, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." Again, Jesus is reiterating the point, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Let me just set the context real quick. Jesus was preaching to a mass of crowds and people. He was explaining to them things about his kingdom. And the crowds left. It says he left the crowds and went into a room by himself with his disciples. And there he is explaining to his disciples these parables. And he tells them about the hidden treasure and the pearl of great value. And so he tells them this parable, and you have to remember, a parable is a short story that teaches a moral principle. And sometimes we can get lost trying to figure out what was the guy's name, and why was he in a field, and what kind of field was it? Was it a cornfield? Was it a rice field? Those details don't matter. The point that Jesus is making, it's not in the details where you find the point. It's in the overall message. And so here we find this first parable, that a man was walking through a field. And as he's walking, I guess he randomly takes a dig and finds a treasure chest. Opens it up and says, "Ha ha! I just found treasure." The Bible says he quickly covered it up, ran, and sold everything he had. That means he ran back to his tent and said, "Guys, listen up, get out the tent, I'm selling it. I'm selling the big screen TV, I'm selling the armoire that no one likes to move anyways, I'm selling everything, I'm selling the Chevy Camels, we're getting rid of it all." And you can imagine his family like, "What are you doing? Like, why? You're selling all our stuff. Like, why are you doing this?" And he says, "Because I found a treasure that is far greater than all of our stuff we have." So that's one story Jesus tells. He tells another story very similar. There's just one difference, that the merchant, the guy looking for pearls, was actually looking for treasure, a pearl of great value. And it says that this guy knew what he was looking for, and when he came across a pearl, his reaction was the same. "I found this pearl. I'm selling everything I have because this pearl is greater." This is a story that Jesus tells his disciples. He was willing to give up everything for the treasure and the pearl. Why? Because they knew that what they were gaining was far greater than what they were giving up to receive it. Does that make sense? So you might be sitting back and going, "Okay, Brad, well, what's the treasure? What's the pearl to us? What point was Jesus making? Here's the point, guys. Two times, one in each story, it starts off, the kingdom of heaven. And the other story with the merchant, it says, again, the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus is saying the kingdom of heaven is greater than anything this world has to offer Brad or has to offer you. The kingdom is greater, and nothing compares to the greatness of the kingdom of God. You see, when you encounter the kingdom of God, you will joyfully give up everything you have so that you could gain the kingdom of God. That nothing else matters except the kingdom. So you don't sit back and you don't view this cost of discipleship as a burden. You don't view it that way. You look at it as joy because you're saying, I'm getting the kingdom of heaven, and that is greater. And so this morning, I'll show you an illustration. I asked Kelly the other day. I said, Kelly, imagine if I told you that you had to empty out thousands of dollars from our bank account. And I was like, wait a minute, scratch that. Let's say you had to knock out $100 out of our bank account. Give up everything we have, sell our house, sell our cars, give away the cat, whatever it is, all that stuff. And I said, but here's the catch, Kelly. You give up everything we have, but I'm going to give you access to all the banks in America and across the world. What would you do? She's like, get out of my way. I'm going to go sell it right now, right? Because here's the reality, is that to give up the little we had to gain something far greater is not a sacrifice. Are you with me? It's not a cost to give up little to receive abundant. Now, catch me. I'm not talking about if you follow Christ, you're going to have abundance of money in your account. That's not what I'm talking about. But the illustration works in the sense that we're willing to give up something little so we could get something far greater. The Apostle Paul, he said it this way. See, when he understood what the kingdom of heaven was, when he understood what the treasure was, in Philippians 3:8, it says this. Paul says, indeed, I count everything as loss. Why? Because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. Why? In order that I may gain Christ. Paul says the only thing that matters is me knowing Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. See, when we understand that Christ and everything that he is about and about his kingdom, we understand that his kingdom is greater and his kingdom is worth seeking. See, the kingdom is greater than the cost of discipleship. And I want to unpack, because here's what happens. I think sometimes we don't understand what the kingdom of heaven is. We don't understand what we receive being a part of God's kingdom. And so we're not willing to pay the price of being a disciple because we don't truly understand what we gain as a part of God's kingdom. So this morning I want to unpack just four quick truths about the God's kingdom. You could go on and on for days. The kingdom of heaven is mentioned in the New Testament, the Gospels, over 100 times. Jesus said a lot about the kingdom of heaven, and the reality is that the kingdom of heaven matters, which is why he spoke about it a lot. But I think we need a clear understanding of what it means to be a part of his kingdom so that we no longer view the cost of discipleship as a burden. Here's the first one that I put in my notes. I wrote it this way. Forgiveness is greater. Forgiveness is greater. As a part of God's kingdom, you receive forgiveness. Look at what Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. He says this, he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. And catch this, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. The Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, penned these words many, many years ago. And he tells us that, look, there's two places you can be spiritually. You're either in the kingdom of darkness or you're in the kingdom of heaven. And the only way to be in the kingdom of heaven is through Jesus Christ and his blood. And he gives you the forgiveness of sins. And what Paul points out is Jesus, when you place your faith in him, takes you from darkness into the light, his kingdom, and gives you forgiveness of sins. Because all of you are like me. I was born into this world as an evil, wicked sinner. Everything I wanted to do in life was something that benefited Brad. I didn't care what God wanted me to do. I didn't care about pleasing him and honoring him. I wanted to make every decision that filled my passions, that filled my desires, and so I went out and made mistakes. I sinned. I brought sin, guilt, shame, embarrassment. I brought regret into my life because I was living on a path where I was looking to please me. We're all in that same boat, not just me. But here is where the beauty of this passage comes to light. That in the midst of our worst sin, no matter how big, tragic, grave, no matter what it looks like, that God saw from above his children created in his image, bearing the guilt, bearing the shame, bearing the struggles, bearing everything that brings people down and makes them depressed and sad and hopeless. He saw all of that, and out of his great love, he said, I will bear the weight of sin. I will take the wrath of God on my shoulders. Why? So we could experience his forgiveness. I want you to think about that for a moment. Every sin that we have committed in the past, maybe it's a sin we're committing now, or maybe it's a sin we commit in the future. Guess what, church? Catch this. Those sins are forgiven. Did you get that? Did you understand what happens to your sins? That all those sins that hold you back saying, I'm not good, I can't be a disciple because I've messed up, those sins are forgiven through Jesus Christ. You don't have to bear that sin and shame. You see, so many of us disqualify ourselves because of the sin that we've committed and say, God can't use me. God doesn't love me anymore. I want to bring your attention to Revelation chapter 1. Because when we begin to believe that our not forgiving ourselves is greater than God's forgiveness, what happens? We're paralyzed. We no longer go and make disciples. We sit back and go, oh, I can't make disciples. I've sinned. That's the story of the cross, guys. All of us have sinned. But look at what Revelation 1, 5 through 6 says, and this is what I want you to catch. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, King Jesus, to him who, what? What? No matter what that sin is that you think you can't get forgiveness for. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ, those sins are forgiven and you are loved by King Jesus. And it goes on and says, to him who loves us and has what? Freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And now catch this. Through your forgiveness of sins, what Jesus Christ did for you, you are now a part of his kingdom, loved by God Almighty to serve him. You've been put in a priestly order, meaning we've all been commissioned to serve and make disciples despite the sin. And here's what I want to ask you. I'm going to ask you this question here. Is it hard or a burden to share with other people that their sins, their mistakes, can all be forgiven and that they can be loved by God Almighty and loved by their Savior? Is that hard? But we sit back and we say, oh, the cost of discipleship's too hard. I don't think I can't do it. It's not my job. I'll leave it for everybody else to do it. How can you not share the joy of having your sins forgiven, where no matter what you've done, your guilty hands, you can stand forgiven and spotless and blameless because of your faith in Jesus Christ? We want everyone else to experience what that feels like. And when you have that joy of forgiveness, church, guess what? You will make disciples because you understand that the kingdom is greater, that forgiveness is greater. Here's the second thing I put in my notes. I said it this way: freedom is greater. Freedom is greater. I'm going to read to you a passage from Matthew chapter 6, because when we make life about our stuff and what the world says we need to have to survive, we miss this truth of what freedom is. Because God's kingdom brings freedom. Verse 25, it says this: therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious about anything, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. Here it is. But seek first the what? Of God and his righteousness, and catch this, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Jesus was giving this lesson in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. And in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus radically changed his followers' perspective. The world says that we should operate in one way, seeking stuff. It was the same thing for them when Jesus was giving it. They were seeking power, wealth, status, stuff. The more riches you had, the greater and more popular you were. Folks, that's the same problem we have today. And Jesus is telling them, look, that is not what the kingdom of God is about. The kingdom of God is not about acquiring stuff. The kingdom of God is valuing what God values. And so here we find out where Jesus says, look, your life should not be about acquiring material things or keeping up with the latest fad or focusing all your life on your career and doing all these things, because that's what we make life about. Society makes your life all about you and making sure you're taken care of. And in the process, when all you can worry about is yourself, do we make disciples? No. And so Jesus says, look, I want to give you freedom in life. I want to give you freedom where you have the time, the energy, and the resources to make disciples. But here's how it is. Don't make your life about getting your clothes, your food, your whatever you're going to do. Don't make it about that. Trust your Father who sees and knows all your needs. Allow him to provide. But here's the thing, though, that we have to remember, that what we need doesn't look like what the world says we need. And sometimes we think, well, you know, I've tried trusting God and God's going to provide for me, but he doesn't give me the 60-inch screen TV. It's not what God values. Well, I don't have the fancy Bentley. My car's broke down half the time. It's not what God values. When we sit back and say, you know what, I'm going to allow God to provide for my needs, and to trust him. Because see, when we read those verses, how many of you love the truth of those verses? Who loves it? I love it. I love the truth. Now, here's the next question. Don't put your hand up. You love the truth, but do you live the truth? There's a difference. It's people who love the truth that God provides. But how many of us have truly experienced and lived that truth, saying we trust God with everything? We let him provide for us. You see, Kelly and I, when we first got married, we went through a wedding crash course, like a marriage crash course. We moved to Kansas City, I'm terrible at math, but like 2 months after we got married, we moved to Kansas City. And we went through financial chaos. Like, it just seemed like we got declined at a dollar store. Like, it's those kinds of things happen to us. And I remember telling Kelly, and normally, like, finances, they say, are like the one big thing that can destroy and ruin marriages, right? And so we're like, man, we're broke. We have nothing. And it's like these bills are coming due, and our bank account is not a bank account, and all these bills are coming due. What do we do? So one morning I woke up, Kelly was still sleeping, and I went out and I started reading the Bible, and I came across the Lord's Prayer, where Jesus said, "Give us this day our daily bread." And so I just stopped on that part right there. And I said, "Okay, God, I don't know how my finances are going to get worked out. I don't know how we're paying bills. But you say, give us this day our daily bread. So God, whatever that bread is for today, provide it for us because we're trusting you." Now, did God bring a limousine into my life? Did God bring all these fancy clothes into my life? No, but here's what I can tell you. When Kelly woke up, I told her, I said, "Here's what we're going to do, Kelly. We're going to pray that God gives us our daily bread. And however that works, it works." And I can tell you that God met every need, not every desire. Now, that was 5 years ago. You might say, "Brad, that was 5 years ago. What about today?" Well, whenever our bank account gets low, we sit back and go, "All right, God, you provide. You're our provider." We're not going to freak out about it, because sometimes in marriage, it's like, "Kelly, why did you spend that much money on shoes?" And she's like, "Well, why did you go to the Dolphins game? They just lose anyways." And it gets into this whole fight. I'm sorry. But what happens is in those moments, couples begin to fight, and they argue, and they blame, and they wonder, and they get mad, they get upset, and then marriages are destroyed. Because why? Because we're worried about stuff. Because we have to pay for stuff. And Jesus says, "Don't worry about stuff. Love me, seek my kingdom and my righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you." Are you with me this morning? Okay. Psalm 34, 9 and 10 says this. Look at this verse. It says, "Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. For those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing." In modern terms, you lack nothing when you seek God, when you fear God. Matthew 6:33 has the greatest reminder: "Seek first his kingdom and all these things will be added unto you." The kingdom is greater than the cost of discipleship. And when you're free from trying to acquire stuff, you have resources, time, and energy, and strength to make disciples. And you will want to tell other people, "Look, there is a way to have freedom in life where you don't have to worry." Is that a burden to share with people, that your Father in heaven will provide for you? It's not a burden. It's not a sacrifice. It's a joy to share that. Here's the third thing. I put it this way. Identity is greater. Identity is greater. Church, all of us, many of us in here have struggled with identity. We've all had a point in time where we wondered, who are we really? At the end of the day, Who am I? Where do I belong? Where do I fit? Where do I get acceptance? We all have this desire to want to be a part of something great. But for many of us, instead of seeking to find identity in Christ, we find identity in people, in relationships, in careers, in sports, in hobbies, or social media, where people panic if they don't get 50 likes, like they've done something wrong. And so people try to find their identity in everything else but God. See, I was talking with Dr. Hill earlier this week, and he gave me amazing insight. Because what Satan does is he is very good at offering us the fruit. He's able to make this fruit look so scrumptious, like I just want to bite it. And then when you eat the fruit, you realize that you are not satisfied, that there is still a longing for something more. And so what do? You go back to Satan's tree and you just start picking off his fruit. You start chasing everything else because nothing is lasting. Nothing is satisfying. And we think, and no matter how many times we go back to it, that fruit will not satisfy. But what Jesus offers us is the seed. And the seed, when it is planted, cultivated, taken care of, and allowed to grow, becomes a tree. Satan offers you a fruit that doesn't last. Jesus offers you a tree that will completely satisfy. Remember, he's at the well with the woman, and he says, look, I can offer you water where you will never thirst again. You see, we settle for cheap things to try to find an identity. And Jesus said, I came to give you life and to give you life abundantly. I want you to look at Luke chapter 12, verse 32. He says this, Jesus is talking, and I love this. He says, fear not, little flock. You might say, a flock of what? A flock of sheep. And I love the illustration for myself because I know that I am a sheep. I want to like go off on my own direction, but I constantly need God to guide me back, to show me what needs to change, to show me how I can follow him better. And so he uses the perfect word and says, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. See, when you place your faith in Jesus Christ, God becomes your Father. You are now a child of the King. That's your identity. You with me on that? So when you place your faith in Christ, you are now God's child. You are a child of the King. That is your identity. And here's what I know happens in life. People can give us negative labels that we begin to live and we begin to hold out. But if you allow Christ to give you your identity as one of his children, you can boldly say, people say, well, you call me a failure, but I am a child of the King. You call me a loser, but I'm a child of the King, people. You call me worthless, but I'm a child of the King. You call me stupid, but I am a child of the King. You call me anything you want to, but I know that I am a child of the King. You see, when you understand your identity in Christ, it gives you confidence to live and to move forward in your life, not caring about what other people think. You love Jesus. Yep, I do, because I'm a child of the King. When you embrace Christ and his kingdom and your identity, you not only have a new identity as one of his children, but you are also part of a huge family. And I think this is something that we forget about, that we don't ever really think about, that we don't sit back and understand the principles of this truth and realize that there is much to be gained when we realize that every Christian in this room and across the world is now a part of our family. Some of us come from families of all different sizes, small, big, large, whatever it might be. But all of us today that have placed faith in Christ have a huge, huge family. And we are here to help each other grow in our faith, to pray for one another, to encourage one another, to love one another. And this is why you hear us talk about all the time, join a life group. Because none of us were created to do life alone. When we seek to do life alone and say, I don't need to be a part of the Christian family. I can do church on my own. I don't have to be a part. Here's what happens. Your growth in your faith becomes stagnant. You don't grow. Because I know I have people in my life that come to me and say, Brad, you need to tighten up. Here's what you could do better to be a better follower of Jesus Christ. And they encourage me. They lift me up in prayer. When I have stuff going on that I need prayer, I can turn to my family and have them pray for me. You see, Jesus shares an important truth. And I've learned this personally in my life. Luke chapter 18, verse 29 through 30 says this, and he said to them, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom who will not receive many times more in this time, meaning your lifetime, and in the age to come eternal life. Jesus is saying, look, you might have to give up brothers, sisters, and friends and family to follow me. But when you become a part of my kingdom, you have way more family than you know what to do with. Now, here's the point I'm trying to get at, church. When I was 17, my dad passed away. I lost a father figure. And so I was like, okay, how do I know how to become a man? How do I know how to grow? Like, how do I know how to love my wife? Like, how do I know how to handle all these circumstances? I had no dad. Well, being a part of the church family, I learned an important truth, that this body is filled with many godly men who have wisdom, who have love, who have support, who have encouragement, who've invested in me and helped me become the man that God wants me to become, because I was willing to say, they're my family. They care about me. They love me. And so I know the value of allowing this family to enter into your life and to help you grow, because there's so many people that are a part of your family that want you to be all that God has created you to be and can help you. And so the question is, will you allow them to help you get your identity in Christ? When we realize our identity as God's family, it encourages us to make disciples. 1 Peter 2:9 says this, says, but you are a chosen race. Everybody who's placed their faith in Christ, you're a chosen race. You're a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation, a people for his own possession. Why? Why are we all these things? Why are we considered this? Why is our identity important? Here's why. Because when you understand who you are in Christ, you're able to go out and proclaim the excellencies of God. And tell people, you need to be a part of God's family. Because there's so many people out here that are walking around hopeless without identity. And God is saying, will we share with them that you can truly be accepted and loved and belong to a creator and a savior who loves you? Is that a burden to share? Nope. Is that a cost that is too high to share? Of course not. That's a joy to tell people that they can be a part of God's family, his kingdom. The kingdom is greater than the cost of discipleship. Here's the last thing. Victory is greater. Victory is greater. 1 John 4:4 says this, little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. You see, there might be some Christians in here this morning that feel defeated. Some Christians in here where Satan has constantly reminded you about your past sin. Has he been able to get you to believe that you can't do anything about it, so you might as well just sit in it and live it? Do you feel defeated because of a habit, an attitude, or an action? Would you like victory in your life? You see, Jesus says that greater is he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Well, who is he that is in me? If you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you have the Holy Spirit within you. And the Holy Spirit is greater than any sin, is greater than any temptation, it's greater than anything that Satan is trying to do in your life. You see, the Holy Spirit gives us victory over past, present, and future sin. We don't have to walk into defeat. Instead, we can walk in victory. You see, it is only through His Spirit that we're able to overcome any inadequacies, any weaknesses, any habits, any hurts in our life. And Jesus, and here you see where John says that greater is the Spirit who lives in you than anything that you struggle with in your life. Not only is the Holy Spirit with us and gives us victory, but in Romans chapter 15, 13, this is what the Holy Spirit does for us. It says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. There's many of us that have walked through a situation that was tragic, that was devastating, but somehow we're managed to overcome with joy and peace and hope. Who is that? It's the Holy Spirit of God who gives you the strength, who gives you the hope. And we have victory that no matter what we go through, no matter how tragic, we know that God is there with us, that as we look to Him, there will be joy, there will be peace, and there will be hope. But not only that, Galatians 5, 22, 23 says this, that this is what the Holy Spirit does in our life. The Holy Spirit produces valuable things for His kingdom. This is what God values. Look at what it says. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such thing there is no law. That is what God values. And the Holy Spirit, when we allow Him to work, will work those values out in our life. Why? What's the purpose? So that we can be a disciple and make a disciple. That we can show love, that we show joy, that we show peace, because that is what Christ is doing in our life. So the Spirit gives you victory to be a disciple because you're not making disciples in your own strength. You have the Holy Spirit inside of you. Here's the last thing that the Spirit does for us. Ephesians 3, starting with verse 16, says this, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length in height and depth. Here's the greatest victory, the greatest treasure we have as Christians, folks, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to Him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. We realize the kingdom is greater than the cost of discipleship when we realize that the treasure is the King. When we treasure and value Christ, we realize that knowing Him, to know His love, to know His grace, to know His forgiveness, to know His mercy, is worth forsaking everything for. Because when we come to Christ and place our faith in Him, He gives us forgiveness, He gives us freedom, He gives us identity, and He gives us victory. And I love what Paul says here, is that when Christ's Spirit is working in us, He does far abundantly more than we could ask, and he finishes that with, or you could even think about asking. And so discipleship is never done in our own power or our strength. We sit back and say, well, I'm just not good enough. I got all, no. You walk in victory because of the King that you love and the King that you serve. We don't consider the cost of discipleship as a burden because it's a joy to share with people that they can become a part of God's kingdom, which is greater, where they can find forgiveness, freedom, identity, and victory. There's a powerful clip that I would like to show you. Just when you watch, I just want you to listen to the words that this anointed poet has spoken about this idea of God being greater. He says it so perfectly. Go ahead and check this out.
And here we stand, toes wet from the dribbling Jordan lapping at our feet, our digits in river, our heels on sand, fearful our journey might end in defeat. For the river seems to move more jaded, not fluid, as it did when we first crossed its flowing sheets upon its bare bed that was made naked by that famous prophet's cloaked feet. For his strength was ample when he took up his mantle and struck the water's solid beach. But now here we stand, our feet in sand, and all we want to do is retreat. We've all stepped up to this stream and heard the current of voices rushing through our heads that make our legs forsake his dreams for the sake of our screams. He couldn't have met me, we hear ourselves saying. I'm too weak, too ignorant, too meek, too indifferent. I'm too sinful, too lost, too simple for this cause. I'm a lawbreaker, a God traitor. I'm not fit to do this noble labor. And God looks down upon us wild excuse makers and says, no, you may not be great, but I in you is something greater. And that's when we start to remember when we received our call, that dream within our depths with which we are enthralled, and how for such a purpose God has withdrawn us away from the normalcy which formerly charmed us, how we left the idols to which we used to bow, as did the prophet, the farmer's life disavowed, and in a holy act of sacrifice, we too took up our sacred cows and left them all behind, burning on the plows. Now, here we stand, toes soaking in the Jordan, God's mighty cloak in our hand, his power, our fortune. This river is our proving ground to test whether our calling is certain. Our purpose lies on the opposite shore, where we stand sits complacency and boredom. Now, at this point, you may begin to feel burdened, but remember, you do not fight this battle with your own strength, but with his whose victory is already determined. These waves may be weighty, but his power is weightier. Your doubts may be binding, but he will be your vindicator. The torrents may be rushing, but he will be your savior. The call you receive may be great, but he who shall accomplish it is far greater. Now, take up your cloak and with all the strength you can squander, lay everything down and strike the water. God himself will be your partner as the waters begin their departure. Your waves of guilt and apathy will turn to walls of his adequacy. Your floods of fear and doubt will turn to ramparts of Jehovah's shouts. And stretched out before you, there will be not a raging sea as there was hitherto, but a solid path of confidence, and you'll make solid prints of providence as you march on to what you were born to do. So to all of you, sick of playing it safe, getting by on good behavior, God is saying to you that he has something greater. To all of you dreamers, disillusioned by the desire to be a world changer, God is saying to you that he has something greater. To all of us Christians who want Christ but not his cross, just want him as our savior, God is saying to us that he has something greater. He is saying, lay down your lives for the life of your neighbor. Give in to the demands of enemies and of strangers. Be the world's lover, though they be your hater. Sacrifice your bodies, not just your behavior. He is saying, show love in your flesh, not just your Bible's paper. Be the shattering of rods and the yoke's breaker. Make allies with weakness and be power's traitor. Develop a distaste for strength, while meekness you shall savor. He is saying, be a peacemaker, suffering saver, forgiveness curator, justice laborer, grace vindicator, true love translator, and his people shall answer. We will burn the plow, strike the water, be the good life slayer. We will be a church unsatisfied with being great, but we'll make ourselves nothing to make him something greater.
See, he understood that when he knew that Christ was greater, it would lead to him proclaiming and for us proclaiming that in Christ is something greater. The kingdom is truly greater than the cost of discipleship.